3, initiating broadcast of fascinating nouns in 3, 2, 1.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Fascinating Nouns. Now if you are listening to this transmission, we are still the galaxy's most trusted source for incredible people, places, things, and ideas. Now together we arrive at this curious nexus point, and we will explore the strange, unusual, offbeat, bizarre, intriguing, interesting, invigorating, quirky, quaint, quizzical, weird, wild, wacky, the fun, the frivolous, and the fringe, plus all the spaces in between. I am your host, Daniel J. Glenn.
Hello, Fascination. Welcome to the show. So, you know, I love insects. I can't help it. I'm not ashamed of it, and I don't want you to insect shame me. But this is really one of my favorite things. And maybe today's topic, it might come from my youth, because I grew up around cicadas. And for those of you who are unfamiliar, I think these might be one of the most unique insects you will come across, because they only come out every 13 or 17 years. Now, I should say periodical cicadas only do that. There are some that come out every year, but those aren't as interesting. We want to know what's going on underground where these things are they're hanging out for almost two decades. We're going to find out that answer because I've got Dr. Gene Kritsky on the show. He wrote a great book called A Tale of Two Broods. And that's because this year, 2024, marks a very unique event, one that happens once every 221 years, and that's the emergence of the 13-year brood and a 17-year brood coalescing right around the southern states into Illinois. So this is a once-in-a-multi-lifetime event, and we're going to talk about it today, and I can't wait to get into it. So Dr. Gene Kritsky, thank you so much for being on the show today. I just want to make sure I got all your bona fides correct. So you are an entomologist, and you got your PhD in the University of Illinois, so you're not unfamiliar with the territory. I mean, and that's also the perfect place to get it, because there's a lot of cicadas and a lot of broods running around.
To put it, my undergraduate degree was in Indiana. I worked with Frank Young, who was the cicada specialist for Indiana.
Okay,
My PhD in Illinois, I worked with Lou Standard, who was the periodical cicada specialist for Illinois.
Okay.
And my first full-fledged mapping project was in 1976, Brood 23 in Illinois.
Wow. And
so I've been doing this. I started working on cicadas 2 years earlier, so this is my 50th year of working on periodical cicadas. I'm that old.
Wow. That's pretty cool. You know, I'll tell you, I just learned that my grandma retired in 1976, and she's still alive. So she's been retired for almost as long as she was old when she went retired, as 1976. So during a cicada emergence, I can't wait. You know, one of the things I loved about your book, just as a little bit of foreshadowing, is cicadas they play such an important cultural role in the areas where they, you know, they spring out, where they emerge. You know, it's mm-hmm. definitely my childhood littered with cicada and nymph casings. I want to get into some of the cool historical moments that took place during these cicada emergences. But, you know, it's kind of cool. So Illinois, you know, I'm from Chicago. I love singing their praises. And if I understand it correctly, so there's a difference between periodical cicadas and annual cicadas. And for those of you who are not aware, these are a gigantic flying, well, gigantic's, I guess, a strong word, but a relatively large flying insect mm-hmm. that they only come, the periodical ones only come out every 13 years or every 17 years. This kind of blew my mind. I didn't really understand how it worked. So we're going to get into that. But in Illinois, correct me if I'm wrong here, doctor, there are broods 3, 10, 13, 19, and 23 that all overlap in Illinois. So several times in a decade, you'll get these emergences. Is that right? Is that many?
That is correct. The overlap is very minimal between any of the broods.
Okay.
Lewis Standard, my PhD advisor to Illinois, did a publication in 1974 where he mapped these out. There are small overlaps between broods, but Illinois is one of those nice states that's got five broods to work with.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. I mean, and it's interesting because you would think that anyone listening, if you're studying these, you know, they come out every 17 years. Oh, there's a lot of, as a researcher, there's a lot of downtime there, doc. There, you know, yeah. Can I call you Gene? Can I call you Kritsky?
Sure.
What do you like?
You can call me either one.
Either I like Kritsky. That sounds like a sports name. You know, if I was throwing you a pass.
That's what my colleagues at the university refer to me as. It's almost like a noun. It's the Kritsky.
The Kritsky. Yeah, I love it. The Kritsky.
I was a dean, so you have you get that.
A lot of respect. The Krits. So I want to hear about how you got into entomology, because it's kind of a cool story. And it didn't happen. I mean, it's not like you grew up loving insects or setting ants on fire with a magnifying glass. I mean, you got into this kind of in a weird way.
That's true. I originally wanted to go into bioanthropology and study human evolution.
Oh, and okay.
I was taking a human paleontology course from Paul Jameson, my professor at Indiana University, a newly minted PhD. Mm-hmm. And I started saying, this is 72, so there wasn't a lot of fossil material like we have now. And mm-hmm. I'm looking at the two casts of these skulls. I said, how do you know this isn't just the male and this is the female? And he starts going on about this morphometric analysis. And he just says, take an entomology class. That's where we're doing a lot of this fundamental research. Didn't think anything of it. So I went to register for classes as a sophomore. Sophomores are the last of the classes to register. And this is in the days you didn't have the web. We had to go collect computer cards from a gigantic field house and then assemble them in the right order and what have you, and then turn them in. And so I was thought the sophomores were the last. And then there was a cohort base within that class. And the Ks were the last of the class.
What's going on with that? They're K-ist.
So I walked up to the table and I said to the woman sitting there, I need 5 hours. Is there anything left open? Mm-hmm. And she says, I'll never forget this. All I have is entomology in the lab. So I took it because they said, Paul said, take an entomology class. So I did.
Sure.
And it's taught by Frank Young, who was the periodical cicada specialist for the state of Indiana. And in the second week, he starts talking about these periodical cicadas. And I changed my major.
Wow. I'm a big moment for you.
It was one of those eureka things. I tell my students, get upset when you don't get what you think you need. The serendipity can change your life. And it did me. And so what hit me was, as a frustrated historian, and I'm guilty of this as well with some of my cicada research. All of us that study cicadas, we experience an emergence, and we're making all these observations based on this one emergence we're experiencing. And that's just the data point of one. And I thought, really, to understand what's going on here, I need to look at historical records. And and of course, I talked to colleagues in the journalism department. I said, well, how do you go about doing this? And I learned about primary documentation, secondary records, tertiary, and so on. Sure. And so when I went to work on my PhD at the University of Illinois, I worked with Lou Standard, who was the cicada specialist there. And I decided I'm going to start collecting historic records. And by the time I finished my PhD, I had an excess of 7,000 records.
Wow. Yeah.
Going back to 1634. And I had this massive amount of information. Now I'm a full-fledged entomologist. I got a PhD. I'm just really psyched on this. But it's like, what do I do with all this? And Steve Jobs comes to the rescue with a Macintosh, and I find this program for the Macintosh, which was designed to allow marketers to see where would be the best place to put a golf course. And what was useful about that program wasn't about golfing. It was that they had a great mapping program, and I could convert all my records to the FIPSI code, which it used. And then I could say, okay, give me a map, and I'd list all these years from my database that I wanted a map points put on from. And that gave me like a massive map for brood 10, for brood 14, for brood 13, and so on. And I could see patterns as I was looking at them by century and by current distribution.
Wow. So unlikely hero in Steve Jobs, by the way, the man who I say is the person who's destroying modern society. He came to save you, which is I think the iPhone is crippling the world, but you've used it very well. You've used his mapping system very well. Unlikely story here, Gene.
Well, it's just today before we started this, I was online with all sorts of feelers going out there looking for evidence of Irish bee towers. There were at least these were large towers built upon honeybees and monasteries and things like that. They've all been torn down, but I'm trying to eke out little bits of information here and there. And I was on sabbatical at Cambridge University back in 2001, 2002, and I found some books that I was able to go through to find, look at architectural drawings of buildings and what have you.
Sure.
Now I can get them online like that.
Boom. Yeah. But isn't it more fun to go into the field, though? Isn't it more fun to head out into the Irish countryside? I don't know. I'm imagining Irish bee towers would be in Ireland.
And that's part of this. I will be doing that. But the big, most effective use of my time, I didn't know where to go.
Right.
Fair enough. So other than teaching in universities and colleges or doing field research or agrochemical testing, the only thing I've done is worked in libraries. And so I love wandering through. I called it prospecting. To find these records for historical records for periodical cicadas, I would do what I call prospecting. In some case, I would just walk into a floor at the University of Illinois Library, and I just pull a book off the shelf at random to see what I could find. And it's amazing the stuff I was finding. Before I wrote my book on ancient Egyptian beekeeping, I sat down for about 3-4 months, not all 8 hours a day, but periodically for 3 months. Mm-hmm. And there was like 12 bookcases of Egyptology books at the University of Illinois. And I went through every single one of them, one after the other, and marked down anything on insects in ancient Egypt.
Well, I want to talk. So this is a great segue because I wanted to run down some of your books. I want to talk about you a little bit because I don't want to call you an odd creature, but you have an eclectic taste. I mean, they're centered on, you know, the insect world. But you mentioned, you know, ancient Egyptian beekeeping. I mean, you've written a book on that. I'm curious, like, how I did a whole episode of this show on modern beekeeping, and I'm curious how they differ. But I don't want to go down that rabbit hole. But we may have another conversation. You wrote a book on dinosaur evolution, a 6-volume set on called A Cultural History of Insects. And I'll be honest, I didn't even know insects had a culture, so that's pretty impressive. You wrote a book of poetry on the orders of insects, which some of it's pretty good. And two others. These are my two favorites here, Gene. Comparative material and mechanical properties among cicada mouthparts. Cuticles enhanced with inorganic elements facilitate piercing through woody stems for feeding. I feel like it could be a little more pithy, but that is a pretty descriptive of what you were researching for sure. And the last one here, personality mediated speed accuracy trade-offs in mating in a 17-year periodical cicada. Now that sounds like speed dating for insects to me. But so a lot of stuff here. These are pretty interesting volumes. So you do your research for sure.
Loose standard that drove into my brain that the work's not done until the paper is published.
That's very true.
Otherwise, it's just something. One of the great joys of being a scientist is there is a moment where you are the only person in the world that knows something, a particular esoteric fact that no one else is even worried about and are staying at nights thinking about it. And then when it's published, other people get to enjoy that find.
Yeah. And you get credit for it, too, which is pretty cool. I mean, you get to be the guy who discussed, you know, inorganic elements in mouth parts of cicadas. I mean, you're that guy now, right? I mean, that's I just love the word mouth parts and insects because it's a funny word, you know.
Yeah.
I was trying to explain it to somebody.
And that's what happens to a kid who was born in North Dakota and grew up for the first 6 years there. Go out and loved to collect fossils. And things like that. My grandparents homesteaded North Dakota.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So I am that old.
Wow. That's pretty cool. It would be interesting to go back and figure out like your ancestors. I mean, are there cicadas up there? I guess not. They wouldn't really have experience.
They have annual cicadas.
Okay. That's every year.
That's every year, it's a little different.
Yeah. So what is it? I mean, you're probably one of the most foremost experts on periodical cicadas. Why? You know, that you said you were in that entomology class and 2 weeks in you hit the cicadas and you were hooked. What was it about them? Like, why in God's name are you dedicating your life to studying these creatures that only come out, you know, it's not quite like Halley's Comet, but it's very, very few and far between do these emergences happen?
Well, one of the nice things about periodical cicadas is there are 12 broods of 17-year cicadas and 3 different broods of 13-year cicadas, which means out of a 17-year period, 12 out of those 17 years, you're going to have periodical cicadas somewhere.
Okay, and so, right.
So I've visited every brood except one, and that was because it was a year that they merged along with another cicada population I was more interested in, and it was a discovery I was in the middle of. So I will say that my cat was one of the few cats in history that got to enjoy periodical cicadas every year for 5 years. Because I bring them back home.
Whoa, that's pretty cool.
I bring them home for the cat.
Oh, that's to eat?
Oh, yeah. He loved it. Oh,
well, what's interesting about cicadas, and I want to say this now because I think I will forget, is that one of their keys to survival is emerging in such large numbers that all the predators eat as many as they can and basically get full and sick of cicadas. And they hope, and the cicadas hope that there are enough of them left over after that purging, or binging, I should say, after that binge to then mate and lay eggs for the next generation, right? I mean, that's kind of a trait that's almost exclusive to insects.
That is true, although I'm not sure if they're actually hoping that there'll be enough left.
But I feel like in their little brains, they're like, oh, please don't let me get eaten. I need to mate.
But yeah, it's an amazing phenomenon. And in my 50 years working on these insects, I probably have 40,000 photographs of cicadas. And, you know, they all look alike, except for some minor differences between the species. And every time this happens, I'll spend hours in the evening to document the transformation of the adult. I just find that a fascinating thing to do.
Well, I'm going to put some videos, some molting videos on the website with us, because I was watching two or three of them. It's a pretty cool process. You know, I remember growing, you know, when I was growing up, just seeing the little brown husks stuck to a tree. I don't think, you know, I always heard cicadas as a kid. And I'm guessing I saw them pretty often. So I imagine they were probably annual cicadas, because the thought that they only came out every, you know, decade plus was foreign to me as a child. But because I remember seeing them every summer at my grandmother's house. But I remember just seeing the little brown things, sticking on the wall, wondering like what came out of there, you know, like in your little brain, like what emerged from this little brown husk. So it was a very strange process, but I'm gonna put some of those things up so other people can enjoy them. So this is, you know, we're talking about this here in 2024, Gene, and this is a big year because this something that's happening this year only happens every 221 years, and that are a 17-year cycle and a 13-year cycle brood are emerging at the same time. And I think if I'm correct here, there will be overlap. And this is something, you know, this is brood 13 and brood 19. This dual emergence only happens once every 221 years. Last time was 1803. Our republic was, what, 27 years old, if my math is right? Is that right? This is really bigger than a Halley's Comet moment. This is a once in a multi-generation moment.
That's right. Well, Thomas Jefferson was president at the time.
That's pretty cool.
In his garden book, he even talks about cicadas emerging 1 year, and it turned out to be a brood 2 years. So he was even interested in cicadas back then.
Is that right? So Tom, were there any stories about him getting? I love to hear. So I really want to try to weave in some of these stories of historical moments that happened during the cicada emergence, because they come out in such large numbers that they kind of affect things that happen at the time. You know, so was there anything with Thomas Jefferson? Did he give a speech and have someone sitting on his shoulder or anything like that?
No. Well, one thing about Thomas Jefferson is he was the first person to write essentially an extension circular on control of an insect, the Hessian fly. And so
really?
he was a scientist. He did a number of applications like that and projects like that. But he wrote in the garden book that I think it was 1775 is when he wrote this, that next year was going to be a cicada year. And they came out 17 years earlier. And that's all he wrote. But I was very pleased to see a U.S. president talking about periodical cicadas. I mean, there are a lot of things. Teddy Roosevelt, for example, wrote, "Thank heavens I learned my natural history at the foot of Thomas Huxley and Charles Darwin." It's not often you hear a Republican president say that.
No. A different time. That was a different time for sure.
And as I say, and if you want to talk about bugs, Richard Nixon had a totally different idea.
What was his idea? I feel like he... What? Well, oh, you mean the audiobooks? Yeah. Yeah, he was a fan.
I did have a communication with Jimmy Carter about his interest in insects. And
really?
He wrote me a handwritten note years ago. He wrote a book called My Life right after he was left the White House. And it was he had two chapters in there on fly fishing. And one of the chapters went into great detail of the orders of insects and their behavior and what have you. So I wrote him about it.
Really?
And he basically told me that he was into insects when he was a peanut farmer because there are peanut pests. Yeah, but that since then, fly fishing and the insects involved with fly fishing have occupied his entomological pursuits.
That's great. Well, and I imagine, you know, with all the Habitat for Humanity stuff, I mean, he's building houses in all sorts of habitats, you know, it's in the name. There's lots of insects he's got to encounter for sure. Well, it's funny because, you know, growing up, when you hear about these emergences and you see news reports when they're coming out, these are events, right? Those are people who live in these areas. These are moments in time. These are moments in history. People don't forget them and they want to experience them. You know, I can't tell you how bummed I am that I live in California, you know, thousands of miles away from a dual emergence that only happens once every 221 years. I got to find a way back to Illinois, Gene. I got to experience this myself.
Well, after doing this podcast, this become a tax write-off for you.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Hey, you know, there's got to be a financial incentive for sure. So I want to talk about one other thing. One other thing in history really quickly before we forget. Can you tell me, before we move on, the Bob Dylan story, the 1970 Bob Dylan cicada story?
Well, certainly. 1970 was a brood 10 emergence year. And Bob Dylan was getting an honorary doctoral degree from Princeton University. And on his way to get the diploma, go through the ceremony, he picks up David Crosby of Crosby, Stills, and Nash. And they arrive, and David Crosby sitting on the front row with all the relations of the honorary degree recipients in baggy, apparently, allegedly, I've not seen the photograph, in sort of beat up blue jeans, eating an orange. Okay. And on the platform is Bob Dylan waiting patiently to get his award. In the background, the periodical skaters from Brood 10 are screaming.
Mm-hmm.
And so after the presentation, he gets up, he takes off his cap and gown, hands it to somebody, gets in the limo, and off he's gone.
Right.
And he goes back home and writes a song, "The Locust Sang for Me."
That's great. That's fantastic. Well, and it's funny because, I mean, it involves Bob Dylan. This is one of those moments in history that cicadas influenced. But also it's the nomenclature here, Gene, locust. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is not accurate. And I imagine as a cicada expert, you know, you must, this is, they were called locust going all the way back to the beginning. This is inaccurate, Gene, and this has got to bug you.
Well, the history behind it, I've actually published a paper on this history. When they first were reported by the Pilgrims in the history of Plymouth Colony, they were referred to as large insects, like with bigness to bumblebees. It wasn't until 1715 that we have our first account of a brood 10 emergence in Philadelphia, where Reverend Andrea Sandell said, these strange insects have appeared. The English call them locusts.
Mm-hmm.
And an unpublished paper, which I have since included as a chapter in my first book on cicadas, The Plague and the Puzzle, published by the Indian Academy of Science, I was able to find a manuscript by Paul Dudley of Massachusetts. And he had experienced the 1699 emergence of Route 11, massive. He lived outside of Boston. He, again, in 1716, and again in 1734, I think it was, or 33. And he writes this paper and sends it to the Royal Society. And after they read the paper, they never published it, because throughout the paper, and a big discussion afterwards, he was calling these things locusts.
Mm-hmm.
And so they wrote him about this, and he said, "Oh no, I went to Reverend Weld, who assured me these are locusts." And Reverend Weld was using the King James Version of the Bible.
Yeah,
they knew that the indigenous populations ate locusts. John the Baptist ate locusts. They come out in massive numbers, like plagues. We know there's plagues of locusts in Exodus. There's other verses that he used as well. So that was where that name came from. And we see populations, for example, even in Australia, they initially called the cicadas locusts. and based on part of biblical interpretation of what they were seeing. So he writes that back to the Royal Society. They in turn response that they couldn't agree with him. So they arranged to send Egyptian locusts from Cairo, Cairo to Boston in the 1730s.
Wow. All right.
And they got there. Now they were dead specimens, but so it took probably 2 months. And but he receives these things. He writes a letter back thanking them for sending the specimens and admits that, yes, he had confused cicadas for locusts. And then he says, but I don't care what the learned say, the common folk will say this for a long time. And he was right. I think we finally got with all due respect to Bob Dylan, we finally got the name locust out of the vernacular for these insects, probably in the last 34 years or so. But it's been prevalent.
That's 34. So you're 1990?
I don't want to indict any of my institutions of higher learning, but there was one production, I think it was in 1987, that referred to cicadas as close relatives of crickets.
Really?
Locusts are close relatives of crickets, not cicadas. So that still hangs out there. And some of the older people I visit and talk to, they may have grown up calling them locusts.
No kidding. That's so funny. I mean, yeah, I grew up before 1990. I remember they were always cicadas to me. That's so interesting. And it's also, you know, with all of your, you know, all the research you've done in the history of people, you know, documenting the emergence and the chronicling of all of these insects, it's kind of interesting because what you're doing now is very high tech. You know, you mentioned the mapping programs, and in your book you talk about, I think it's Cicada Safari is an app where people can take pictures and document where the cicadas are if they see them in their area. This was kind of done in an analog fashion in 1850, I believe. I think it's Gideon B. Smith. He basically used mapping at the time and crowdsourcing from the newspaper to get people's anecdotal stories on where they saw them, what they were doing, and get their emergence. And that's kind of how he put together, you know, in a rudimentary way, the broods and their, you know, the area that they occupied and everything. That's pretty cool. I mean, that's inventive. You don't think about that, you know, when we're so high tech now, we forget that there was an analog world before.
Well, he had experience with newspapers. He was a medical doctor by training. Okay. And early in the 1830s, another medical doctor, also from the University of Maryland, where they both got their degrees, wanted to do his research on the 17-year locust. And he needed an assistant because he actually wanted to do that 34 years earlier and never got around. He's too busy. So he looked for an assistant, and he hired Gideon Smith to be his assistant. And Smith was an assistant to the editor of a major agricultural newspaper.
Okay.
And between the two of them, Smith and Nathaniel Potter, the other medical doctor, they published the first standalone book on periodical cicadas with a color illustration, hand-painted illustration, called the 17-year locust. Potter died in 1843, so Smith took over. And he started sending out these little articles. He'd send it like the New York Times, and the Wall Street Journal, like national newspapers. He would send out a notice to this one of these national newspapers. I'm expecting the cicadas to emerge in Mississippi this year, and I'd appreciate it if your readers would send me notice. And they did. Wow. But there was one year, particularly 1858, he was so anxious to verify cicadas in a particular location, he promised to return people's stamps to them if they told him of cicadas.
Really?
And that was because he was trying to verify for certain there were such things as 13-year cicadas.
Okay.
And so he was crowdsourcing before crowdsourcing was even thought of. And when a small anecdote, when his manuscript he wrote on, that he had a rather detailed manuscript on cicadas that never got published, but it's referred to by several great entomologists in the late 19th century and the early 20th century. We didn't even have a photograph or a painting of this guy. And in 2021, I'm talking to a reporter from the Washington Post. I'm telling him this story. And I didn't think anything of it. A week later, I get an email from an individual who was a student worker in the Goucher College Library. And somebody had turned in a family collection of papers. It turned out to be Gideon Smith's great-great-granddaughter.
Really?
In there was a picture of Gideon B. Smith.
Whoa, what are the odds? I'm probably the only one.
That's the only way we know so far. And a few weeks earlier than that, I was wandering through the web, just looked up Gideon B. Smith. And there was an auction in California of a letter signed by Gideon B. Smith. It was signed, the letter's not about cicadas. He was responding to a query about the agricultural newspaper of which he was the assistant. But he wrote the letter in the name of Skinner, who was the editor, and he signed it. Gideon, so I was able to get my hands on that letter. So we now have his autograph and a photograph.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
I find it somewhat symmetrical, if you will, that we find Gideon Smith's photograph through an interview crowdsourcing cicadas.
That's pretty crazy. That's pretty meta, Gene. That's pretty nuts. That's were you the only person bidding on that, or were there other people who were interested?
I was the only person that was there, but there was one other bidder, and I'm sure it was somebody in-house to drive up the price, because I'd sent in an early bid. I thought, okay, I'm just going to – the bid went up $20.
Yeah.
And, all right. Then they knocked up to another $20, and I just said, screw it. I don't really do it that bad.
Yeah.
I lost the bid, and 10 minutes later, I get an email. The previous bidder has withdrawn his price. And so I think the auction house had somebody there jacking up the price to see how much, because there's a photograph of Dale Evans and Roy Rogers that sold right before mine. Yeah. By getting that went for $800.
Huh.
And,
I think the fix is in, Gene.
Yeah.
So I think they had an inside man.
I think so, they did too, but they only got me for $20 more. But it's nice. It's nice to have his autograph, something that his hand. I have a piece of paper that he actually handled. I've got I've got Darwin letters in my collection. There's something about having things like that that have their cooties on it. If you
sure, yeah. That's right. No, but it's true. I mean, it's funny to hear a scientist say this, because we do as human beings have this weird magical thinking when it comes to items, right? Like you want a baseball that was, the 62nd home run hit by Aaron Judge or the 72nd one hit by Mark McGwire. It's like, well, I mean, it's just a ball hit by a bat. It just happened to have, the bat had to happen to have been touched by, a historic figure. But we have that. I mean, I'm completely guilty, of the same thing. Yeah. But we do feel that way. It's just funny to hear, scientists talk about that kind of magical touch, that you call it cooties, but it's really just, it's just them touching it. Right. It's pretty interesting.
Yeah. I tell my students there's something about a wonderful biography on Charles Darwin called The Power of Place. Mm-hmm. And I've been to Darwin's home many times. In fact, back in the 90s, I was asked to clean his insect collection. And it was kind of dusty. And sure. I've worked with his great-grandson for many years before his great-grandson passed away. But there is a power place. So my wife and I have been to Czech Republic. I've been to the monastery where Gregor Mendel did his experiments on peas. Oh, I've actually stood in the place where he grew his peas.
In the garden,
I saw the foundation of his greenhouse where they did the indoor painting. I was interested primarily because of Mendel was a beekeeper.
Okay.
And so I was given permission to actually, they brought in what, they still have some of his beehives. And so I was able go through the beehive and describe that and what have you. And so it's a, that kind of stuff. That's the power of place, to be there where Mendel grew the peas and to realize that, you know what he did when he was done counting the peas?
Yeah.
They ate them.
We can throw them out. Yeah.
He developed a variety that was sweeter than the others and was favored by his brothers. And so
that's amazing.
Things like that. And I've been to Olduvai Gorge and walked down to where they found Homo habilis. There's something that's I just enjoy doing, to be there, to be see the place and be part of that.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's just, not to go on this philosophical non-cicada rant, but it is interesting because what's different between that and a place of worship, right? Like, I mean, the parallels between religion and science, they're not as different as people would like to have them believe, right? I mean, scientists still want to see the place, you still want to see the place that Mendel, basically created or started DNA. I mean, started genetic engineering, I mean, that's really what it is. And that's sacrosanct to you in the same way that, the Vatican is sacrosanct or Jerusalem. Jerusalem is sacrosanct, mm-hmm. Bethlehem. We're not as human. It's a universal human trait. You know, right. which is just so interesting to see. Yeah. But well, you know,
if I can, for me, it's the primary document.
Okay.
I wrote a book on ancient Egyptian beekeeping, and I had photographs of all these places, but I wanted to see the original site. So I've been to the tomb of Babasa, the tomb of Rekmere. I've been to the Neues Museum in Berlin, where they have the oldest relief of beekeeping in the world. I wanted to see the primary docket for myself.
Yeah.
And in my book on that, I present all the evidence in there for this. So the readers can see, oh, this is just some conclusion I have. Here's the stuff. I describe every scene. I had to take a course that was offered at the Smithsonian to figure out how to read these hieroglyphs.
Right. Yeah. But it's the stuff, right? I mean, it's the primary source, which is mm-hmm. really interesting. And, you know, and I think, you know, the awkward transition with the passage of time. I'm going to use that as my transition, because one of the things that I thought was always strange about cicadas is, and as a kid, this is why I didn't really believe some of these stories, was that they live underground for 17 years. That seemed crazy. I mean, that seems too long. What's an insect doing underground? I mean, are they living the whole time? I had no idea what was really happening. And I think that they have a very strange life cycle in some ways, you know? So I want to just talk about the cicada itself for those who are unfamiliar, because you start, I think we start at the nymph stage instead of the egg stage. I mean, typically you'd start, you know, life at the egg stage, but the egg stage is part of the end. And it's really when the nymph emerges from the ground that the action begins, let's say, because it's dormant. This is a species that's dormant for almost two decades and then has this, you know, 6-week orgy and then goes dormant again for like another two decades. It's kind of strange.
I don't know if dormant's the right word to use, because they're down there. They're sucking on a tree root. They're growing. Right, they're tunneling. They're not moving very fast. You know, it's kind of cool down there. It's usually around 56 degrees.
Yeah.
But they're tunneling. If they tunnel the wrong way and don't find a tree, they're going to die under there.
Stakes are high.
They're sucking on the xylem fluids. That's the nutrient ore. They're growing very slowly as they grow, and then they molt. They molt four times underground, but after a couple molts, they move a little bit closer to the surface. They're about 8 or 9 inches then. The deepest I've ever found them, the year that the eggs hatch, they'll start feeding on grass roots for the first few weeks, and then by New Year's Day, they're about 8 to 12 inches below the surface.
Okay,
and they stay
About 6 months after hatching, then roughly.
I'd say five to six. Five, but that's perfectly fine. And then as they continue to molt, to grow, when they're about 7-8 years, they're going to be about 4 inches closer to the surface. They'll be in that 4 to 8 inch share range now for the next, you know, anywhere from 4 to 7-8 years, and. Right. But they're not. If you dig them up, and I've done this because, you know, you got to do something with cicadas every year.
Right.
They're moving. They're not going to run away. They're moving because they're cold. They're cool, but they are alive under there. And so they're not hibernating. They're not sleeping. They're doing what cicada nymphs should do. They're sucking on a tree root and slowly growing and getting ready for his adulthood. That is different, but it's also, you know, you're born as a human. That's your start, and you're under your parents' thumb for the next so many years, and then finally you become a teenager, and then you think your parents are crazy. And then you finish your degree, and then also you realize your parents are pretty smart and they got some cash. And so on. But, you know, that's just their life history strategy. It's what's enabled them to do what they're doing.
Well, I think it's strange in that, I mean, obviously, if you compare them to humans, it's not strange. But if you compare them to other insects, I mean, there aren't a lot of insects that seem to have a period of relative inactivity. I could say that, right? I mean, where they are underground. I mean, we can agree that sucking on a tree root for 17 years could qualify as inactivity in comparison to ants who live underground and are very, very busy. So it's strange in that respect. All right. And so they're underground, they're growing, and they're not growing much. I mean, you know, they're going from an egg to 3 inches long over the course of 17 years, which is a very slow, it's a slow burn. And then somehow And I'm guessing we still don't know when this timer goes off. The calendar flips. I don't know if they have little mini calendars underground. It flips over, and the 13 or 17 year, they're, you know, right around May, they're like, hey, we gotta go. Everyone send the alarm, mm-hmm. send the message out. We gotta get out of here. Mass text to everyone, and then they come up. It's a mass exodus from the ground, and they tunnel up, and they climb a tree or some tall structure, and then they molt, and then they become the adult, and then they do what they do. I mean, is that mm-hmm. pretty much, that's the beginning. That's the beginning of this whole thing, right?
Right, right. Although there are some cues that tell us they're getting ready. So, for example, okay. they're working in their gardens right now in a brood 13 or 19 area, and they should encounter a cicada. They'll have red eyes, the nymph, mm-hmm. the immature. They won't have these two black patches behind the head. The red eyes form usually in the late fall the year before.
Okay.
Just today I saw a photograph that someone had submitted that was clearly a cicada nymph. I'm pretty sure it was a periodical cicada nymph, but the eyes were white, which told me that's not going to emerge this year. That's going to be in the future.
Okay.
And so, but when the soil temperature reaches, now, and you're right, we don't know how they remember what year it is, but they mm-hmm. determine, they can count, that they can determine the passage of time by the fluid flow in the xylem every spring. And that when the tree leaves out and produces leaves and flowers, mm-hmm. if it's a flowering tree, they can sense that. And that marks the year. What we don't know is how they remember what year it is.
Right.
That's the question. And then in their 17th to 13th year, when the soil temperature reaches 64 degrees Fahrenheit, 4 to 6 inches below the surface. Mm-hmm. And I have found that if you have that day with a nice little bit of a rain, not a deluge, but a nice good rain to soften things up, that's then they're going to pop. And they're going to pop in big numbers. But they all don't come out in one night.
Okay.
It takes about 2 weeks for all the cicadas to emerge in a given place. And I had some students do some experiments back in 2004. A tree on a south-facing hillside, on the south mm-hmm. side of the tree, mm-hmm. doing temperature probes, the cicadas came out on the south side first. Over the course of the next 3-4 days, they came out on the north side because it was cooler, warmer on the back side of the tree. And on the north-facing slopes, it was a week after that.
Okay.
Because there was never any direct sunlight. So it's like, it's not like you're going to miss it if you don't get that one night. that 2 week time period of all these cicadas coming up. But the average adult cicada was about a month. But because it takes 2 weeks for them all to come out, the ones that came out last, they got another month to go. So the whole thing is going to take place in about 6 weeks.
Okay. And that's a relatively short period of time, right? I mean, it's not mayfly short, but it's 6 weeks as your adult life. That's pretty short.
Well, again, we're being anthropocentric when we say that. For them, it's probably they only have one thing on their mind, and once they've done that, 85% of the males will mate only once and then die.
Well, now hold on a second here, Gene, because you just compared nymphs living underground to being a teenager and growing up. So I think we're both guilty of being a little human centric here. So
I'm not at all disagreeing with that at all.
so they grow. So the nymphs come out. They're these little brown. They look like beetles without shells. I guess I don't know how really to describe them. That's probably a terrible description. Mm-hmm. But they go up. They climb, and then they emerge. They kind of come out of the back of this of their form. They molt right out of the back, and then they hang upside down, and then their wings unfurl, which is this really cool moment when you watch a molting video where they have these, you know, they're rolled up, they're shriveled little wings, and then they just fill with a liquid and just completely become full-fledged wings. That's a mm-hmm. pretty cool moment. And they're white. I mean, they're like albino white, which is kind of strange. And I think they darken overnight, right? This happens usually at night, I'm guessing, and then by the morning they're ready to rock.
They'll start coming out after sundown, but some of them will be coming out just before sunrise, or even just as in the morning when it's just beginning to get bright. And if one day you wake up in the morning and you go outside, let's say it's noon, you see shells everywhere, that you didn't miss it. Mm-hmm. If you get up a little bit earlier during the day, the next day, you'll find some still shedding their skin, before 10 o'clock in the morning.
Okay.
But if you find empty shells, that's that should tell you, okay, go out that night. Get the kids, get flashlights, go out there. It's going to be fun.
Oh, cool. I've never done that. Now, that's a great idea. Yeah. So when you see the first shells, that's when you know, okay, we got a couple more days of this. This is going to happen. Yeah. So I want to kind of weave in the life cycle with the... the morphology is how they're structured, right? So
it's your appearance.
Because this is really cool because you have male and female cicadas, and you know, insects, head, thorax, abdomen, all that stuff. You know, six legs. But this is what I love about cicadas is that and I think cicadas, you know, I'm going to be misogynistic here. I think cicadas got it right because the men make the noise, the women are silent. So I think they got it right. You know, I think the men talking is the way it should be. I'm really kidding here, Gene. But you, the men have they've got. I'm joking.
You're not unique in that. The Greeks had a poem that says, half our cicada lives, for they have silent wives.
But it is now, it is strange because when you
like, I wouldn't like that, but I I'll let you get the letters.
I take the full heat on that. But it's interesting because the male cicadas, their entire abdomen is built almost like an acoustic guitar. They've got the noise making organs. They've got a kind of a hollow center that resonates out. They even have, you know, they're so loud they even have covers for their own ears, which is nuts. And that same section, the abdomen in the female, is egg laying. They've got this really cool ovipositor, which is kind of this knifey tube that cuts into wood and lays eggs. So they're structurally very different. And the females are silent. They basically snap their wings to say like, yeah, hey, you know, I like what you're saying over there. And then they hook up, and you know, that's how the birds and the bees and the cicadas, that's kind of how it works. But this is to me, I really like these noise making devices. It's really cool structure that does this.
The timbals.
The timbals.
They are. If you catch an adult, a male cicada, you can pull up the wings. Just at the base of the wings, you'll see these little white areas, and it's white because the white tells you that the exoskeleton there has not hardened. And if it's dark, it's tanned. But what they do have are all these little cuticular ribs that when muscles pull it inward, it causes a little snap, and they do that so many times a minute. And we have several of those ribs. That's what causes that sound that we're talking about, the call. And it's really cool to watch.
Now, I imagine that's when I was in, I don't know, third or fourth grade, and we had music class. Everyone, you know, there's a percussion instrument. It's basically this ribbed piece of metal, and you take like a drumstick and you just run it over that. It's kind of like a washboard in a way. Is that kind of what it's like in obviously miniaturized fashion and much faster?
It's not like hitting something. It's like taking when I was in high school back in the olden days, when they had to make thunder, they took this big sheet of metal and they sort of rubbed it.
Yeah,
it's more like that. It's more like a popping sound. Or those clickers that you can...
Click, click. Like dog training.
You've got like 30 or 40 clickers all going at the same time.
That's intense.
Several times a second.
Yeah, that's a little much. So this is the adult form, and then you know I think they touch bottoms and then they have sexual reproduction. Male fertilizes the female, and then that's kind of it. And then they go off, and then everyone kind of dies after 6 weeks, and then the females go up and they find a tree, you know, a fruit bearing tree is typically what they like, a tree branch. And then how do they tell me a little bit more about this ovipositor, because this thing was pretty cool to me.
Yeah, it's a neat structure. It's a ova for egg, positor for deposit. The cutting surf structure has a central rod and then two parts on each side, which is serrated at the very tip. And it sort of alternates, slides back and forth over this rod. And as they're pushing that into the terminal growth of a tree branch, they're literally sawing in just below the bark. And then as she's pulling out, she lays eggs as pairs, pulling out along the little egg nest, usually between 20 to 40, depending on the female. And then she walks another half of an inch and she does it again. And she keeps doing that until she runs out of eggs or she runs out of twig. If she runs out of twig, she then flies to another branch and continues doing that.
Right.
And I was kind of intrigued about how many eggs are really in a female. So I had a student who wanted to do a research project on cicadas. So we decided to take female cicadas from three different broods, and we dissected out the ovaries, and they'd already been they were already pickled, so it wasn't that, but they hadn't laid eggs yet. Mm-hmm. And so we were able to determine that the average around was a little over 500, with a range of between 400 to almost 600.
Okay.
So you get an idea about the numbers here. If they have a 1-to-1 sex ratio, which they do, and half those millions of cicadas you see are female, and she can lay up to on the average 500 eggs, you get an idea about the literally trillions of cicada eggs will be laid in a major emergence.
Yeah, that's a lot. I don't know what the numbers are, but that seems like a lot.
Well, what it also tells us is that there's a hot that's all very the nymphal stage, the underground stage is very precarious, because literally we should be several feet thick in cicadas if they all survived, but we aren't.
Right.
So when the eggs hatch, beetles, spiders, ants go after the newly hatched nymphal cicadas, so they got to get underground really fast.
Yeah.
And I have actually collected newly hatched cicadas and watched them do this. It's really quite amazing. Within less than a minute, they're underground.
Wow.
Again, that's so precarious for them. And what do you think? What would happen if you're a cicada nymph and you get underground and you break through a wall and it's full of ants?
Oh, God. Oh, that's a nightmare.
Think of the horror of it all.
Yeah. Holy cow. That's misery. I mean, unless, you know, just to anthropomorphize, maybe those ants take the cicada in and he becomes one of their colony. You know, we don't really know how that.
Well,
is that a Disney movie? That's not how life works, I don't think.
I think he'd become one of the colony, but not necessarily as an individual. He'd be contributing nutrients for some of the colony.
Yeah, fair enough. That's probably exactly what happened. So this, you know, I want to talk about one thing here. So one of my interests as a pretend scientist is mind altering parasites. You know, I did a whole episode dedicated to mind altering parasites. You know, the cordyceps mushroom is one of my favorite. It's not my favorite. It's the scariest. It's the most intriguing, I think. But there's a mind altering parasite that affects cicadas. You know, it's the Massospora cicadinia. Did I say that? Did I nail it? Now, this is a white psychoactive fungus that can both infect nymphs as they come through the soil, I believe. They can be infected by the spores. And it's also sexually transmitted. So this is, you know, they can be subjected to sexually transmitted diseases as cicadas, which is terrifying. But this is a pretty interesting parasite here. Yeah, I know you're not an expert in this, but tell me a little bit about how this works, because I found this fascinating.
I am co-author of the paper on this.
Perfect.
But basically, again, we don't know how the initial infection occurs on the soil underground. And late in the emergence, usually around like third week or so of the adults out singing away, you'll start seeing the infected adults. So that's time for some of the many of the cicadas to actually mate and lay their eggs, and then they get infected. It's interesting in the sense that if a male is infected with this fungus, he becomes hypersexualized and starts acting like a female. So he'll hear a male nearby sing. He'll flick his wings to lure the amorous male in. And instead of being a female for mating, he's got an abdomen full of cicada spores and or fungal spores, excuse me, and inoculates the next male. Right. So that's... and of course, what's really wild is that the whole tip of their abdomen falls off, and they can be flying around with this thing spreading spores throughout their environment.
Well, I mean, the thing you forgot to mention, and I was reading this article on this, is that their genitals basically like slough off, like they fall off. I mean, so like the male genitals are long gone.
They're gone.
Replaced with, you know, spore based. An equivalent, but
it's a chalky mass. It looks like a big piece of chalk in their abdominal cavity. It's basically a big mass of fungal spores that's sort of a cream color that they're flying around with. And as the fungus is growing, and I've seen this many, many times, the abdomen gets distended, and you can see the white through the membranous regions of the abdominal segments, and then the tip of the actually the outside of it falls off, and it looks like the size of a cigarette, for example, and it's white and it's just exposed.
Wow. I mean, I always just find it, nature is amazing because you have these parasites and these predators and everything lives, they're in parallel, right? I mean, these spores don't exist without the cicadas. They're completely dependent on them, and they're highly evolved to affect only those cicadas. And I'm guessing this is species specific. I know with the cordyceps, they affect different grasshoppers and ants and different types of, insects differently. And, you know, they don't affect the other types at all. This is from what I understand, this mind altering chemical concoction that does create this hypersexual activity is kind of like a combination of an amphetamine and a psilocybin mushroomy type of substance.
Your listeners should not be looking for periodical cicadas with chalky mass breaking off the abdomen and trying to get a little drug fix on that. Please do not do that at home.
No, that is public service announcement. There are better ways to get it if that's what you want. There are easier ways to get it. I think most cicada. Yeah, I mean, don't do it is what I'm trying to say. But this is a very potent mix. I mean, amphetamines. I think I forget what the actual substance is, but it's in bath salts. It's in some ADHD medications. It creates hyper-focused. Obviously, psilocybin mushrooms create, you know, psychoactive properties. So needless to say, these cicadas aren't exactly in their right mind.
That's putting it mildly.
Right? I mean, you know, there's a lot going on there. But this only affects, I think, 1-3%. But it is pretty impressive. So let's tie a knot in this whole thing. So we have the ovipositors putting the eggs in the tree branches. I think sometimes the tree branch can wither, depends on how deep the female cuts into it. They fall off. I think you said in a couple months, 4 or 5 months, they hatch, they're in the ground. And then from that point, when they're sucking on grass roots and they survive the ant colonies and the spiders, they end up going down. So they hang out by tree roots for 17 years. And this is kind of the, you know, if you're looking for the action is the 6 weeks of activity when you hear them, you see them, and they're doing all the reproductive parts. The 17 years, you know, it's relative. You know, I know you scoff at this relative inactivity if you're looking for an exciting time, but they're doing a lot down there.
They are. But I feel the eggs hatch usually 6 to 10 weeks after they've been laid. So they'll be hatching in mid-July into August.
Okay.
And so that's while it's still warm and things. That's important. The adults die shortly after they've completed their process. That flagging that we talked about, the branches break. It looks like that usually is helped by a good windstorm or a heavy storm that causes them to break at weak points. The leaves wither and turn brown so that you can actually see them from the roads. One of the ways we map where cicadas are is to continue mapping even if the cicadas are gone. You give it 2-4 weeks and you'll see this flagging all over the place where the cicadas were.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
And so that's another area way to get more data points. And and I hope your listeners will avail themselves of getting a hold of Cicada Safari. It's a free app developed by the Center for IT Engagement at the Mount St. Joseph University. And we have over 200,000 downloads now.
Oh, wow.
And in 2021, I received over 561,000 photographs.
Cool. Who's going through all those?
We had a staff of 22 went through those. And we're now working on developing artificial intelligence to help identify the easy ones and kick out the ones that it can't work out to get even better and faster data return over.
That's fantastic. Well, so one last thing I forgot to mention. This is one thing I've got to know this, Gene, before we finish up here. When you have, you know, we talked about the cicadas, the males are giving out this obnoxious call. The females are quietly listening. They flick their wings when they're interested, and that's when the magic happens. What is it? What are the females looking for? Like, what is it in the sound? Is it in the size? Do we know what an attractive male cicada, you know, looks or sounds like?
The only data we have about this is a study done a few years ago, looking at what they did is they collected mating pairs of periodical cicadas, and then took a random sample of a large number of individuals who weren't mating. And it turned out that the mating pairs, the males, were slightly larger than the overall average size of the population and for the males in the that were in the population. So apparently for female periodical cicadas, size matters.
well, so that's interesting because they're making all this noise. Mm-hmm. So does that do anything? Well, yes. Are the females just looking for the buff, the jocks?
Well, what happens is that males gather in trees. They're called chorusing centers. They start singing, you know, and this tree will be screaming. I mean, I have measured trees at 96 decibels.
No way. Come on. 96? Really? That's a jet engine.
That's actually louder than a jet engine. I was doing this study at a cemetery on the flyway for Cincinnati Northern Kentucky International Airport, and you did not hear the jets flying over when the cicadas were screaming.
Wow.
If you're in a chorusing forest and you get in your car after 20 minutes, your ears are ringing like you've been to a rock concert for minutes.
Really?
And so it's very, very loud. But as it's not a constant 96 decibels. It'll be 96 and it'll drop down to maybe 88. And then it picks back up again. And what happens after a male has maybe sung two or three times, try to shark a female, if he didn't hear that wing flick or no response whatsoever, he will fly to another tree. And you can watch this. You'll see all of a sudden the loudness and then as the intensity starts to drop, you'll see all these cicadas flying out of the tree. Yeah. And they're going to a tree next door. And so it'll kick back up as others fly into that tree. So the singing attracts females into the tree. And then she is the one that chooses when to flick her wings to tell another male that she's interested. But that's when some males get into competition. You'll have that flicking of the wings occurs just at the end of the call. But sometimes another male cicada nearby hears that call ending and he'll start singing to essentially drown out the end of that call. So she does flick her wings until she hears the end of his call. And so
there's
some games going on. Yes. And the size could be, maybe that's just enough loudness difference that she takes notice. We don't know on that, it's a rather complex. There's three different mating calls. There's one that has a little gap between the two songs, so she has a place to flick her wings. When they're really close, there's one that doesn't have the gap, and then there's a third one that he's actually tapping her with his foreleg and as he's beginning the physical act of copulation.
Got it. Okay. So there's three different songs. I have to say, if you're saying this is 96 decibels, and I don't know that a dip to 88 is much of relief. That still seems pretty loud. But how in the world are they hearing this wing flick? I mean, I've heard it described as like quieter than a finger snap. How are they hearing it if it's 96 decibles? You have to be highly tuned to that flick.
Yes. That's assuming they have an ability to hear all sorts of wavelengths of sound.
That's a good point.
Their hearing apparatus probably only tunes in on their call, and they don't hear the other calls. They don't hear the outside noise or whatever else. So it's a different world to go through life as a cicada.
Very, very different. It would have to be highly tuned. I mean, they do have those ear coverings, but that makes sense. You just tune their ear just to the click, and that's all they hear. They don't even have to hear their own nonsense. Like they're, you know, they're all loud. I guess you'd have to hear some of it so that you know when to do it and when to, there's a strategy. Anyway, we don't know the ins and outs, but I feel like there's another paper in the works here because I want to know the mating songs and how they hear in the audio dynamics, the dynamic range of the cicada. So I'm interested in that. Hopefully that's your next project. Maybe we can work on that together. But until then, how can people get in touch with you? How can they read your various books, your numerous papers, or sign up for this new emergence where they can help you discover where this broods range?
Well, the first thing they could do is download the smartphone app Cicada Safari. It's free. It was developed by the Center for IT Engagement at the university. And it's very easy. Basically, you download the app. We need your email, but we never sell any information or give that out. Because in the past, I've had people submit photographs of periodical cicadas where they weren't expected. And I'll, in many cases, email that person and want to verify what's going on, what they saw. You get the app. You go out and turn your location services on if it's an iPhone or your GPS if it's Droid. and you see a periodical cicada, and you open up the app, it ties into your camera, and you take the picture. At the bottom of the screen, there's a little paper airplane icon. You touch that. Mm-hmm. If your location services are on, and if your photograph is accepted, it sends it to the app. And, okay. And when they start singing, you can submit a 10-second video, which has audio, which has cool. The audio, and I can hear what species are singing. That's also that's very helpful. And when you consider that prior to 2021, the largest study of brood 10 cicadas involved 8,000 points on a map, and we had over 500,000 in 2021. And so that is the baseline. Now we'll be able to compare that to future emergencies. Because one of the things that people can hardly believe is broods do go extinct. Brood 11, which I mentioned a little bit ago about with Paul Dudley and that and the Royal Society, that was a major brood in New England in 1699. The last brood 11 cicada was seen in 1954. Deforestation for agriculture, deforestation for urban development had wiped out the entire brood. And what we're seeing now is with continued land use and deforestation, the distribution of periodical cicadas, if you look at the map in the book, it looks like there's this whole area in the southern U.S. is going to be filled with cicadas. It's much patchier because we've been removing forest land. And what the danger is, these patches of forest get so small in some places that they can't overwhelm the predators.
Right.
And so this is going to help us create baselines for future analyses of land use and deforestation, in addition to talking about cicada biology. And so it's just basically helping us do this mapping, get the app. And once your photograph is approved, it's on there live. You can see if you've never seen cicadas, you don't know where to go. Mm-hmm. You can go to that map, and it'll show you where we've had verified emergence records.
Wow. And I mean, this is Gideon B. Smith's, 2.0, 10.0. I mean, this is doing what he was doing, years later. What about your website? How can people get your books? Do you do social media?
I've learned a long time ago. There was an episode of Saturday Night Live with Betty White, and they asked her if she used some social media. She says, "It just seems like such a terrible waste of time." I do not do social media. I do have a website, genekritsky.com, where people can see my books, and it'll tell them how to order. I think all the books are available on Amazon. But the Tale of Two Broods is available for Amazon from Amazon now, both as an ebook and a paperback. My first book, the Brood 10 book that came out 3 years ago, the Ohio Biological Survey, but the publisher has taken that off sale during this merger, because I would hate to have people buy the book for 3 years ago for this year. And so that'll come back on sale at the end of this year's emergence. Then we'll have two. And I'm already working on the book for next year for Brood 14.
Wow, that's great. I mean, Tale of Two Broods, a great title and a fantastic book. And I'll have links to all of this stuff on my website so people can find it very easily. And of course, that website is fascinatingnouns.com. And we are on X, formerly Twitter, at Fascinating Noun, and on Facebook, at Fascinating Nouns. This has been so much fun, Gene. I mean, there is so much to cicadas. And really, we just scratched the surface. There's a lot with brood interactions, broods going extinct, one's coming out early. There's a lot going on, but I recommend, if you've never seen a cicada, go and see this emergence, because chances are, despite the advances in our medical field, you will not be alive in 221 years. So this might be your only chance to see it. So I'm encouraging people to go check it out, and I bet you would too.
Certainly.
Absolutely. It's
a great time. A splendid time is guaranteed for all.
Definitely. Well, I want to thank you for your time and your research. Thanks for doing all this and for being the show today.
Thank you.
And I want to thank everyone for listening. Have a good night.
End of transmission.